Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to what we hope will be today's webinar on what's happening with mushrooms in China with Dr. Bill Chen. So Bill is just having a little bit of trouble getting online. We ran this as a practice yesterday and his internet connection wasn't terribly stable. So I know he was trying to find a better way of getting online. And that's probably what's holding him up now. But we know he's trying. So we thought, well, we should probably start and just go through the introduction. And I'm hoping that by then he will have sorted out the cable. So China is the world's largest producer and consumer of mushrooms. It is also a research and innovation hub. There are nearly twice as many research papers on mushrooms published from China as the rest of the world combined. Even more astonishingly, nearly all of this advance has occurred within the last 10 years. So Dr. Chen was born in Fujian in China and began his career with Sylvan in 1996. Here he was responsible for introducing new technology to the Chinese industry, developing the market for button mushrooms, as well as enoki, king oyster, and other varieties. During Dr. Chen's PhD, he optimized cultivation conditions for Flammulina velutips in bags, as well as developing a number of animal feed additives that enhance their natural immunity made from mushrooms. His current position is as Deputy General Manager of Sylvan China, where he oversees spawn production as well as R&D. With over 25 years experience in the mushroom industry, Dr. Chen will no doubt be able to provide us with valuable insights to an industry that really completely dwarfs ours here in Australia. Now, we were going to run this as more of a chat between ourselves and Dr. Chen. So type in any questions that you have or comments that you have. Don't wait until the end. We'll just make it a bit more of a round table. Also note that the webinar is being recorded. We will send a link to everyone who registered. So please feel free to share with anyone you think. This webinar is brought to you thanks to the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Centre Project, MU16004, which is funded through the Mushroom Levy with funds from the Australian Government. And we appear to be still waiting for Bill. So unfortunately, I don't know how to juggle, which is a bit of a shortcoming. I gather that is generally the best thing to entertain people with while you're waiting for a speaker. But yes. Here comes the cavalry. Here is Dr. Chen.
I'm sorry. My apologies.
Thank you. No. I just finished your introduction. So that's perfect timing.
You know what happened? I tried to log on and try to get online, and unfortunately something happened and I had to use VPN to get through. So I tried to figure out how to use it. Now, does everybody hear me well?
Yes, we can hear you very well.
Okay, so, my apologies.
Okay. So maybe you should go ahead and share your screen. And
okay.
Yeah,
I sure do that now. Okay, just a moment, excuse me, and let me share.
Yep.
The screen.
You okay? In slideshow. Oh. Not that one. Have you got your PowerPoint open? Ah, there it is.
Yeah, it's open. Okay. And then show it.
Slideshow.
Yes. So, thank you. Thank you, Kim. Thank you, Jenny. Thanks mm-hmm. for Liam's support. And thanks for coming, my dear friends from Australia, from the mushroom community. Mm-hmm. Welcome. Well, it's a great honor to be invited to this great event, and I understand that many people from around the world are very curious about that, what's happening with mushrooms in China. And so here I am. My presentation today will be quite casual. And so if anybody has questions, just please don't hesitate to just stop me and just ask me questions. So yep. Please feel free.
Yep, that's what we're here for.
Okay, good.
Good.
Hopefully I won't get everybody bored or disappointed. So my name is Bill Chen. I've been with Sylvan for 25 years, and I started with Sylvan in 1996. And as a child, I was asked to help some of my uncles to spray water in the mushroom house. So that was my first experience with mushrooms. And in 1996, when I went to the United States and I started training with Sylvan, and somebody from Sylvan asked me, "Now, what part of business are you involved with mushrooms?" I said, "Well, eating." So that was it. I was born in Fujian. Fujian is located in the south of China, and now I'm relocated to Jiangsu province, where Sylvan is building a spawn plant, which is the first plant, which is the first Sylvan spawn plant in Asia.
Bill, yes. I'm just going to interrupt you a bit. Can you remember your microphone?
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
That's better. It'll be clearer. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. So, when I was a child, mushrooms were produced in a very different way, and which I'm going to show you later. So, let's begin with the definition of a mushroom. Now, I understand to a general, or most Australians, or some people, or most people from the West, that a mushroom means agaricus, agaricus bisporus. That means it's this one or this one. Either it's brown or white. Normally, I call this white Caucasian. So. but to a Chinese then it doesn't mean just agaricus, but it can mean many other varieties, such as shiitake, wood ear, orange, tremella, and many others. And there are around 60 varieties that are artificially cultivated in China, and among them 20 of them are very commonly cultivated. And so people in China normally divide or classify the mushrooms into two kinds. One is the so-called straw rotting, and one is wood rotting. And in order to prepare the substrate, people prepare them in two different ways. Now, with the straw-based substrate, people pasteurize it, ferment it and pasteurize it, and then inoculate it, then grow it. However, that wood rotting mushrooms are quite different. The substrate for growing such mushrooms need to be autoclaved, need to be sterilized, cooled down, and inoculated. And so for this kind of mushrooms, people have to grow them in a container, such as whether it's the bag or it's a bottle. As you can see from the screen here, this is a typical oyster log, and this is a typical Japanese style where enoki is grown in bottles. And so people do get used to different kinds of mushrooms in China, and whether it's fresh or dried. And people in China don't mind dried mushrooms because they grew up with it. They normally don't mind. But the situation is changing nowadays because people have access to fresh mushrooms, and many farms are coming online and offering fresh mushrooms. with the development of cold chain in China, and fresh mushrooms are becoming more and more popular, and fresh mushrooms are available to all the families in China, and therefore things are changing in China. So I'm going to show you some figures, and I know that people are amazed with this, with the, some of the figures that I'm going to show you here, because a lot of people divide the mushroom community in the world into two parts. One is the mushroom community, one is in China, and the other is the rest of the world outside of China. So so this chart might explain to you why people might get an answer from here. So this chart gives you an idea of the annual production of mushrooms in China from 2014 to 2019. The figure of last year I don't have yet. I don't think it's quite available in public. So but this will briefly give you an idea of how the production looks like in China. So as you can see, that the total volume of mushrooms produced each year gradually climbs up from 2014 to 2019. Now, those figures include both cultivated mushrooms and wild mushrooms. So, go ahead.
So, Bill, yes. what amount of that increase is due to, what are the varieties that are mainly responsible for that increase? Because clearly it's not agaricus. And nope. I assume that's that right. Most of this increase is due to cultivation, not to wild harvesting.
Exactly. The wild mushrooms are being protected nowadays because it actually destroys. By picking too much from the forest, then it certainly destroys or it ruins a lot of a lot of forest and soil as well. And so so the government has started to take actions to protect the environment, and most of the increase is because then the consumption, the overall consumption in China is increasing. As my family, my friends, they begin to consume more mushrooms, and the reason for the increase is because of some varieties such as shiitake. Shiitake used to be number two in China, but now it has become number one. So in 2019. The shiitake production was almost 10 million tons. And so that's one, almost one fourth of it. That's almost one fourth of it. So we're talking about tens of millions of tons right here. So as you can see from the left, the left column, this dark one, that's the overall production of all the mushrooms. Yeah. So nearly 40 million tons. Valuing around $60 billion.
God. Yes. Oh, wow. So, a lot of mushrooms.
Yeah, that's a lot of mushrooms.
So
shiitake has been a variety being cultivated with the largest volume of for many years. Yes, I think beginning from 2016, yes, shiitake became number one. So black wood ear, we're talking about auricularia, is number two, and pleurotus used to be number one, but now it's number three. Mm-hmm. So, and then agaricus comes number four.
So there's a lot of other varieties in there.
There's a lot of varieties. So if you take it the column right in the middle, then this is agaricus. I know most people care much about this this variety. That's why I listed over here. Mm-hmm. So the situation with Garrigues is that the in 2014 it was 2.3 million tons, mm-hmm. and reached its largest volume in 2016, mm-hmm. around 3.4 million tons, but then it came down. It came down to 2.4 million tons in 2018 and 2019. Yeah. You may wonder why. You may wonder why, though. But we'll get to that. We'll get to that in later slides. And
I think the other striking thing about this graph is how little is going to export. And I mean, we see quite a lot of exported Chinese mushrooms here in Australia, like fresh and dried. So it's surprising that it's such a tiny percentage of the whole.
Well, the total export. I mean, this is. Let me just try to adjust this camera here. Okay, it's better. So this export, if you look at the comparison between those two figures, 700,000 tons in total, mm-hmm. Including both dried and fresh and canned. That's considerably little compared with 40 million tons. But the absolute volume of it. It's pretty large. I mean, if you have to talk about this figure, this is the total export of 700,000 tons to any country at all in outside of China. Mm-hmm. If you compare with total volume that's been produced in the Netherlands or Poland or Australia or even United States, it's quite large. Mm-hmm. But it's a small portion. It's a small portion that compared with the total volume. So I was having a meeting. I was in Congress with one like the friend in Australia, and during the discussion, this good friend from Australia was sharing something. Was sharing his concerns. Now that was in 2008. So during that meeting, he said to everybody at the Congress at the meeting. By saying, if China begins to radiate its increasing volume of agarics to the rest of the world, then we'll be in trouble. Mm. Now, I don't think that it actually has become a trouble at all, because the export volume it remains quite steady, and. People in China didn't have the access to fresh mushrooms before, but now since modern farms have become quite popular, the fresh mushrooms are becoming more and more available to people, and the availability offers the opportunity to educate people and to get people explored and exposed to fresh mushrooms. And people begin to like it. They taste it first, then they begin to like it. That's why the consumption, consumption gradually increases. And that explains why.
So Bill, we have a question here.
Yes.
Jeff is asking, do you know how many people are employed growing mushrooms in China?
Oh, okay.
Roughly. A lot.
Well, that's a lot. Now my figure is about the same size of the population in Australia. So
25 million.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Now that probably doesn't include some of the people who are involved with, for example, lawyers. lawyers.
I don't think we're not counting
government officials who are making making policies for mushroom growing. And that probably doesn't include that, but this figure includes growers, traders, researchers, and teachers who are teaching mushrooms. And I'll say good, they're quite many. So the people who are physically involved with mushroom cultivation, I'll say it's around.
It's like around, every man, yes. woman, and child in Australia started growing mushrooms.
Exactly. just imagine that size.
Yeah,
imagine that. Everybody, nobody's old or young, but he's involved with mushroom cultivation. Yeah. Just imagine that.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So
We should probably I'm just conscious of time. I know you've got a few slides to get through, so.
Yeah, let's move forward.
Yep.
Okay. So this is an official website from the Chinese Edible Fungal Association. So it gives you an idea of what the production is from 2010 to 2018. So if people are interested, they might get online to take a look at it. And it gives you an idea of how wood rotting mushrooms are produced, starting from, for example, raw materials until sales. So this gives you an idea. And more interestingly, that this website offers you where the markets are and what the prices are for each kind of mushrooms that's available on the website. And the quotation in those markets.
Is this real-time information on prices in different markets?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, that's right. So this is a clip. This is a screenshot from 1 a.m. in China this morning. So it gives you, for example, this curve. This is Florida's price curve.
Right.
And these are the wholesale market locations. So people might be able to see that most consumed mushrooms, most sold mushrooms are in the eastern part of China, where the population is. So to give you an idea, this is Shanghai. So this is the largest consumer, and this is Beijing. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And
Bill, could I just ask, if we went on that website, would we be able to see it and translate it into English?
Or is it just
a Chinese version?
No, it's in Chinese. But however, nowadays there are a lot of online translating apps that can be used to help with understanding of it. I believe 95% of this website will be able to translate. It will be able to translate into English.
Okay, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
Go on.
I'm.
No, it's interesting.
Yeah, I'm wondering what the prices are. So you said this is the price for pleurotus that's on that graph there. So what? Yes. Any idea what that would be in Australian dollars?
Okay. The 1 yuan is 20 cents of Australian dollar, and so here the wholesale market. For example, last night the price was 20 cents per 500 grams. That means 40 cents per kilo wholesale.
Wow. And so
okay,
my goodness. And so
no
what about
so many.
Yeah, absolutely. So what about agaricus? What would be the price of those?
I guess that's 60 cents that's 1.2 $1.2 Australian dollars.
$1.20 per kilo wholesale. Kilo.
Yes. Yeah. That's the wholesale market. That's the wholesale market. That's real. Yeah. That's real time price. Real time price. So, I'll encourage people to browse this website, and this is official. So the figures that I just showed came from this website. Like actually, it's they calculate, they make the data. It's made available to the public.
Hmm.
So yeah,
it
so,
is. I mean, you look at those prices and think, wow. You know, if China did decide to grow agaricus and try to export it to Australia, that would be a problem for our growers because that's so much less than our wholesale prices.
Yeah, well, the problem is that the agaricus cannot last. Cannot last very long when it gets shipped outside of China fresh, because of the shelf life. I don't think it can compete with any local growers. Now, as far as I'm concerned, that fresh mushrooms, just very little of that of fresh agaricus is sold abroad. Whether you want to ship it by air or by boat, it doesn't make sense. It's not significant. The only way that's exported is deep frozen. IQF product. That's very little. I know a person that exports IQF agaricus to Japan. It's very little compared with the with right. volume of cans. I mean, it's almost nothing. And so I haven't heard anybody puts fresh mushroom into the rest of the world at all.
Right. So lucky for us.
Oh no! The real challenge is cold chain, especially nowadays. If you want to get bookings to get any products to be shipped out of China, it's very difficult. Very difficult nowadays, especially when the country's locked down. People cannot even travel around, and we have problems shipping spawn into China, and we have problems shipping. I've heard people have had difficulties getting bookings on a boat, and they export logs and some of the products, but the ocean freight is like crazy. It's 20,000 US dollars to any destination.
Yes, so. It's gone up significantly. And we've just had a comment that you can't actually import fresh agaricus into Australia from China. Only from New Zealand, so.
Oh yeah, because there are also restrictions, and I don't think it's quite feasible for people to do that.
Yeah.
Right. So. Sure. Okay. Let's move forward. Okay. It is said that Chinese culture has long history, and I'm a believer of that. So do mushrooms. The history of using. And the images for describing mushrooms can be traced back to Lingzhi on the right, that's Ganoderma. In mountain areas, in a territory of northwest.
So that's a wood rotting fungus, is it? Yeah. Oh, we've lost sound. Bill? We've lost sound.
Do you hear?
Ah, now yes. You're back. You're back. Yes. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Well, yesterday, as we went through this, I now understand it's they are working on the internet cables nearby, and that's why it gets interrupted once in a while, but it gets back. So people just bear with me, we won't panic with that.
I'll be back anyway.
I was panicking because I was trying to get online, and then it didn't allow me to get online. Unfortunately, I use VPN to get out. So now the first image that can be found in any literature at all in China was 8,500 years ago. Now it was on a rock painting, on a rock. So, and from then on, people begin to record or describe mushrooms in different kinds of books, including Taoist preachings, as well as Chinese herbal medicine prescriptions. And nowadays, you find hundreds of atlas illustrations of mushrooms. Now, Lingzhi, Ganoderma, is most famous in China because people have been hearing stories about the about this type of mushrooms. That's just very brief brief mentioning
so what,
mushroom. Yes.
So what is Ganoderma used for?
Ganoderma was used to be prescribed to people that's which is supposed to miraculously cure life or cure disease and save lives.
Just all diseases.
Yes.
Everything.
Yeah. Well, yes. Uh-huh. Well, nowadays Ganoderma has been found to have to contain special triterpene, polysaccharides, the SOD and so forth. And people are using it widely. They make extracts out of it. They use its spores for immunology, for immune system. Mm-hmm. So people grow up with it. Yeah. Okay, let's talk a little bit about how agaricus is grown in China. Now, some of these pictures were taken in 15 years ago. And when I was a child, that means many years ago, mushrooms were grown this way. But in some areas, people are still growing mushrooms in such a way. And I don't think this is quite efficient. Traditional, as they call it traditional, but I'll say this is not no longer tradition anymore. The left corner shows the left bottom corner shows the typical yield of such a farm.
Are they just using ordinary soil on top there?
That clay.
Looks like it's clay, right?
It's clay from. It's clay from the field, and it's mixed with some other materials such like the rice hulls. Mm-hmm.
Who's the gentleman in the middle?
Yeah,
in the suit.
Okay, so this is interesting. This is an interesting picture I took 15 years ago. Some people in this meeting might be able to recognize this gentleman, in a suit. His name is Kees van der Kroon, the ex-CEO of Wakro in Netherlands. Now he visited China, and although he was one of the biggest composters in the world. Now he had to use this simple tool to do the mixing. Phase one. Mm-hmm. So I thought that this would be very interesting. So I want to show you this. This is such a contradiction. A modern composter wearing a suit coming to China using simple tools and do the very, very I'll say traditional composting in rigs. Now people above him. Were not as lucky as he was, because we have to use a lot of people to build the rig and to do the mixing. So this is typical phase one in China. Used to be done outdoors. Now I wonder if anybody will understand what this is all about. This is bamboo and it's hollow inside.
For temperature and aeration.
Yeah, this is there for aeration for the in order to take in air from down below for the chimney effect. So these mushroom farms, these mushroom growing rooms, are built with bricks. Now in some areas, growing houses are built with bamboo structure covered with plastic film and using padded straw as insulation. So air come in and out from this kind of windows that comes with a row in a row. So that was that. This is their ventilation system.
Right.
And so this is very labor intensive, and composting starts at late July when it's still very hot. So this explains why agarics volume in China has come down at around to around 2.4 million tons a year. Because of environmental production issues.
Mm-hmm.
And food safety concerns as well.
Right.
So and the labor costs, this kind of farming is fading away. So then less and less people can endure this type of exhausting work and dirty environment.
Yep.
So that's why modern farms are taking over.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, we should probably, we've only got 20 minutes, so we should probably.
Okay. All right, okay, so let's move on.
I don't want you to run out of time.
okay, thanks. Yeah. So so new farms in China are typical Dutch farms. Now, we're talking about the phase three farms. In most of the new systems, so this is typical Irish style, and this is typical Dutch system, and this is the bunker, and this is the bird view of an Irish farm. So we believe that Irish farms will become more and more popular, and since its cost is much lower than in a building like this. So
I think you mentioned is this the farm that you said yesterday was the largest farm in the world?
Yes. This single farm produces 150 tons per day. It's expanding. They are building stage three now. And so the largest single farm in China produces 150 tons per day now, and they are expanding that size.
So not just agaricus, they grow.
No, just agaricus alone.
Just agaricus.
Just agaricus alone. And the largest company, the largest agaricus company in China owns 5 farms, and in total they produce 260 tons of fresh agarics a day.
Wow.
So
gosh. So that production of agaricus, that total production, is from a very few companies.
That's right.
And then a few little, like the old style growing, but they're disappearing with more of these, but there's only a very few number of agaricus farms who are doing all that production.
Consolidation is going on because small farms are giving are fading away, and they are giving their production away to this kind of farms. However, this kind of farms involves heavy investment. Now this is within a tunnel. This is a tunnel, so this is a typical Dutch system, and some farms do not have phase three tunnels. They only do phase two, but anyone that starts with a new farm will have to start with a pretty large size because they need to justify the investment. So this is an overview of the farm that I was just talking about. Now this is these are already built, and this was taken I think 2018, but all these farms have been completed and I've been running. So they're still expanding the size.
So this is only since 2018, this farm?
Well, they started the construction in 2012.
Oh.
Yes.
That's less than 10 years, and that's enormous farm.
Yeah, that's right. Mm. And the biggest company actually started to produce mushrooms 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Golly. So anybody that wants to get into this kind of business is will have to invest well. Otherwise, otherwise they won't be able to justify the cost.
Mm-hmm.
So so we mentioned how mushrooms are produced now, how are mushrooms sold in China? And people in China prefer fresh food and they like to pick what they like in those markets. Of course, the market shown is slides. Retail markets, and so, mushrooms come to this market through a wholesaler. people who are above 55 prefer to go to this kind of market. And because they want to visualize, they want to be able to see for themselves and feel about for themselves the kind of food that they are looking for. So
it's an amazing range of varieties. Like it's wonderful. Like the colors and textures just look amazing. Exactly.
Just quite appealing. Just quite appealing. So in supermarkets, right in the middle. Mushrooms are displayed with small packages and covered with the breathable film.
Mm-hmm.
So this is how mushrooms sold, and you might be able to read the price right here. This is 4 yuan, and at this in this market. So this is
80 cents.
80 cents per. I'll say no, 1.6 per. 1.6 per kilo. So people normally use 500 grams for as unit. So,
oh, I see. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, how much is sold nowadays? Now, internet has changed people's daily life, of course. And younger people don't go to traditional physical market nowadays. They don't. So they shop online everything, and including mushrooms. So platforms. I've taken over lots of markets. I don't know whether it's good or bad, but with the aid of big data, they build cold chain storage around your pyramids, your premises, and are able to deliver food to your door within 15 minutes, and the maximum 2 hours. So. And so there are a lot of independent apps and built-in apps contained in the social media that offer convenience for shopping. And so take this food ordering app, for example, as an example, that if you search for mushrooms and if you come across a mushroom like this, it shows many nice pictures of appealing dishes. And once you click on this picture at all, it gives you a brief description on how to prepare it with the recipe. And so along with this recipe, then it automatically lists all items needed to prepare this dish, including the sauce. For example, soy sauce or spice, and maybe vegetables or, for example, olives.
So essentially you think, oh, I'd like something with mushrooms for dinner, and you find the mushrooms, and then it shows you options of what you make with the mushrooms. Yes. And then you think, oh yeah, I'll make the soup. And then it automatically orders you all the ingredients.
Yes.
And it comes to your house in 15 minutes.
In 15 minutes.
Well,
in a city, of course. Yeah. Now my wife doesn't go to market anymore, and she prefers to simply use this app and order the food, whatever food that she wants to cook.
Wow.
And so I know
so this is really taking over how people are getting fresh food.
I have to admit that this app developers are so smart. They started to storm you or brainwash you with fragment information, and they totally destroy your patience. And then you don't even bother. You don't have the patience to check the price, and it just click here. You don't have the patience to check the price and make comparisons. You simply click one button and it shops and it includes all the meat, vegetables, and mushrooms and sauce in a package. And before you cancel it, it's delivered to your door.
Yes. You can't even change your mind.
Yeah.
Think I'll eat something else.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's right. So this is what's happening in China, unfortunately.
And
so that's why I said I don't know it's good or bad. So
Does this mean that supermarkets are diminishing? You know, that they're paring them down.
Yeah.
They're
unfortunately
losing
yes.
them in the suburbs.
Exactly. So my father, my mother, they go to physical markets, but my wife doesn't. So I don't think my daughter would do that either, because this is what's happening right now. So okay.
Mm.
So I know it's lunchtime for you.
Yeah.
So I'm being wicked, am I? And so however, I like to show you some of the mushroom dishes and demonstrate how people cook mushrooms in China. As I mentioned that people in China love eating, they have a history of gourmet food, and whatever is needed to make the eating pleasant, they'll find out. And so mushroom can be fried with simple items like garlic green or meat. They can be roasted with or without filling. So this is without filling, this is filling. And so the juice, the broth in this hole tastes really good. A little bit of salt. It's really good. And so mushrooms can be made into a bowl of soup like this. In this case, this is a tremella. This is a dessert. So the simplest and the laziest and most popular way to prepare it is hot pot.
So sorry, that was a mushroom dessert.
Yeah,
it's sweet.
This is actually sweet, this one used to be an expensive, exclusive dish in the past. Only princes or wealthy people could afford it. Now it's becoming more and more available to people in China. So now I was invited to a banquet, to a feast by a friend. Now this table alone had 15 varieties of mushrooms.
Wow.
So that is amazing. With an independent hot pot in front of everybody. And hot pot is considered to be natural, because by eating food with the hot pot, you can simply boil it with less salt, less meat, less oil. And this is a natural way of enjoying mushrooms. And so this is a typical example that was my own experience with that one. So and this is not uncommon in China. This is very common. There are professional restaurants that serve mostly mushrooms, not exclusively mushrooms, but mostly mushrooms. And some of them are chain mushroom themed restaurants. And so while consumers are enjoying colorful and tasteful dishes of mushrooms, they also gain some knowledge and some education on mushrooms. So as I mentioned previously, that Chinese people have had experiences with eating and growing mushrooms for thousands of years. It's their nature to like mushrooms, which have become part of their life. So, let's explain a little bit further. Now, people love mushrooms. Part of it is because it's culture, and they are born with that kind of culture. So Taoism, a practice that had a great impact on Chinese culture and the philosophy of people in China nowadays. Taoism preaches the belief that the human body resembles the inverse. And so and so a person needs to behave naturally to resemble the inverse. And by doing so, he's able to live a happy, natural, and healthy life. So natural behavior, including having natural diet, healthy diet, and mushrooms are believed to be a natural product, and so and healthy. And therefore, people in China don't believe in genetically modified mushrooms.
No, okay.
They don't like it at all. Although people are working a little bit with CRISPR, but I haven't seen any progress made in China yet. And so in a typical Chinese eyes, food and medicine share the same sauce, and there's very very thin line between those two items. So so to a Chinese, but to me, food is medicine, and medicine comes from food. So good food is medicine. It makes you healthy and keeps you fit. So so a typical Chinese medicine prescription, for example, usually contains mushrooms like poriococcus, which is almost essential to a prescription. So and many Chinese legend stories contain mushrooms, describe how Ganoderma miraculously cure disease and save people's life. And so and ancient Chinese medical classics describe the use of mushrooms, and those have been there for thousands of years. So Ganoderma, for example, becomes an image of blessings and good fortune. So you can see this is a Ganoderma museum, a cultural museum, and anything that's related to Ganoderma is demonstrated and is presented in those in this kind of museum. Okay. So.
Okay.
So that's why Chinese are born. They are born with the font of mushrooms, including medicinal mushrooms. So. Yeah.
Okay. We better. We've only got a few minutes left, so we better. may be some other questions too at the end.
Okay. This will be the last slide.
Okay.
So. Most mushrooms will be consumed fresh and prepared as a dish because people want fresh because they consider it's natural. However, scientific findings have proven the nutraceutical and pharmaceutical values of mushrooms. And so, in this case, I was sharing something with this is an extract. We were discussing the extracts of mushrooms with a friend, as you can see from the top corner. And this is a typical extraction workshop of mushrooms. And this is a display of mushroom extracts.
What part do they use the whole mushrooms for the extract, or can they just use the mycelium?
Both mycelium and the fruiting body,
right.
and even the spores, because like Ganoderma spores are very and it's a related product are very popular in China.
Yeah,
and even feed additives are being developed to feed animals because antibiotics are being banned for livestock farming.
Mm-hmm.
And there are many other functional products being made, for example, cosmetics and dietary supplements, and it is believed to be in the future. So I think a lot more efforts will be taken to get this further. So
Bill, I think part of your role with Sylvan is as head of R&D. So is that the theme? So can you tell us what you're working on right now?
Okay. Since we are building a small farm, a small plant in China nowadays, and I am currently overseeing the production of the plant as well as mm-hmm. the R&D, because since I was the first employed in China, and so I take the responsibility of overseeing both operations. So, Sylvan International have been working on research for many, many years. We are professional agaricus breeders, but since we now built something in China, we want to focus and spend more time and take much more efforts in developing the local market here. So we'll get into shiitake and oysters and wood ear, and mm-hmm. since there are many universities that have educated a lot of students that are supposed to become mushroom professionals, mm-hmm. we might as well work with them closely like we used to develop new variety, new strains for shiitake and oysters, and work with them for deep processed products, for example, extracts. And we are interested in developing mm-hmm. the protein, mushroom protein, and mm-hmm. use them as food. Because people have probably heard about the artificial meat. I think mushrooms mm-hmm. will become an important ingredient for that. So this is what we are doing now.
Right. So there's quite a lot of work on that. That sort of extracting protein or extracting sort of pharmaceuticals almost from mushrooms. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, this is totally, I mean, this is a great challenge to myself as well as the Sylvan China team, but we are all excited about it, and we look forward mm-hmm. To make this industry a little bit further. So we like what we have done before, we brought in quite a bit of information and techniques into the Chinese mushroom community.
So it sounds like Sylvan has a pretty close relationship with some of the universities in China. Is that
yes?
If they, you know, you're getting involved in the breeding programs and.
Yes.
That type of activity?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Right. So, right. So that's the key things are the extracts and also the, and breeding new varieties, and not just of agaricus, but of shiitake and oyster mushrooms. And
yeah, I think our colleagues in the rest of the world have done quite enough with agaricus, and mm-hmm. so my focus or the folks in China will be mainly in shiitake and oyster.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
So. All right. Well, we're just after 1 o'clock, so I don't know if anyone's got any other questions or comments for Bill about what's going on in China, but not so, at the moment.
Yeah. Okay.
So we might just finish it off there. Thank you, Bill. So thank you all for attending today's webinar on what's happening with mushrooms on China. And I'm sure, like, thank you so much, Bill. It's clearly a bit of a struggle to get the connection, but you managed it. And so that was great. And thank you for putting that together. So this webinar has been recorded. We will be sending a link to the recording to anyone who's registered. This webinar has been brought to you thanks to the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Centre project, funded through the Mushroom Levy with funds from the Australian government. Thank you very much. And we'll see you next time when I believe Kim Michael Cortez is going to talk to us about microbes in compost.
Yes, Michael will be with us in probably early October, because there's a conference in September. So that will be the focus for the next.
Right. Okay.
And I'm going to pick Bill's brains and get his favorite mushroom recipe. And I'm going to put that up on the website as well.
Okay. Excellent. Okay. Well, thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you. Thank you, all the good friends. And thank you, Kim. Thank you, Jenny, for organizing these activities. And I enjoyed it very much. And hopefully we'll see you again.
Hopefully one day we'll be able to see you in the actual person.
I look forward to that.
That would be really great. Okay. Great. Thank you. Great. Thank you so much,
Thank
Bill.
Thank you. Have a good day.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Bill. Okay.